Welcome to the Truth and Liberty broadcast. We believe we have a mandate to bring godly change to our nation and the world through the seven spheres or mountains of influence. To further this cause, we give away a product every week that will empower you to get involved in changing your life and changing our world. You can register for our weekly giveaway by subscribing at truthandliberty.net. You can also subscribe to our newsletter to receive weekly updates on guests, news, and much more. This is an interactive live cast, and we welcome your questions. To ask a question during the live cast, use the comment or chat features. Now, get ready to dive into this week's topics with our hosts on location in Colorado, USA.
Hello, and welcome to our Monday night Truth and Liberty live cast. I'm glad that you're with us, and tonight we've got a great guest. We've got Janet Porter with us. I'll give her a better introduction later, but we've had her on my television program, and I tell you, she's a fireball. She challenges me. It makes me feel like a wimp. Anyway, you are going to love this, and we've got something special, a call to action that we want to have you participate in, so please stay tuned for that. But this is Richard Harris, and he's our chief counsel here at Truth and Liberty, and he's one that makes everything work. And appreciate you, Richard.
We've got a great team.
Yeah, and we want him to share with you about how you could participate and be a part of this tonight.
All right. Well, we're so glad, everybody, that you're watching tonight. I just know this is going to be awesome. So you've got a few minutes. Be sure to text your and get your friends and family and get them around the TV here. You're going to want to, you won't want to miss this. Speaking of exciting stuff, here at Andrew Wommack Ministries, there's some great conferences coming up here right around the corner. The first one is called Kingdom Foundations, and Andrew's going to be ministering there along with Randy Clark and Bill Johnson. That's actually this week, May 19th through the 22nd. So I think there's probably still time to register, but you better do it tonight or tomorrow. But come out for that, and I'm expecting a lot of lives to be changed at that event. It's going to be fantastic.
And let me mention that this is actually their conference, and so they are charging a registration fee. You have to go and sign up. You can't just show up.
All right. Yeah. So check that out on the website at awmi.net/events. And also Kingdom Business Summit, June 16th through the 19th. Andrew will be ministering along with John Maxwell and Billy Epperhart. So this is about restoring God's kingdom in the arena of business. It's one of the seven mountains, critically important to the culture. Hope a lot of you will attend that. We also have Stand Courageous on June 19th, sponsored by Family Research Council out here on the campus. That's going to be a great event with Jerry Boykin and Tony Perkins and Bishop Larry Jackson. If you haven't made plans yet for the 4th of July and the week after that, we invite you to come out for the Summer Family Bible Conference. The Sunday just before that, so it's all a week-long deal, is the 4th of July, and we'll have the In God We Trust performance, which is just a phenomenal patriotic celebration of everything great that it is to be an American. And I tell you, it'll change your life, literally, and it'll make you glad to be an American, and we need that these days. So check those things out on our website. And then also wanted to mention that if you're not a subscriber to Truth and Liberty, you're really missing out. Go on our website, and in the upper right-hand corner, just click on subscribe and give us your email, and we will begin to send you information and resources every week that are going to help you stand for truth in the public square. We send out action alerts. We send out important news and developments and all kinds of things like that that you don't want to miss out on. And if you subscribe today, you'll be eligible to receive a free gift. Last week, we always give away a free product of some kind. Last week, we gave away Andrew's book, More Grace, More Favor. And Kim Hallman, I want to congratulate you on that. You should be getting an email soon about that and how you're able to get a hold of that. This week, the product we're giving away is called Discover the Keys to Staying Full of God. This is Andrew's book. And I think, Andrew, this is based on Romans chapter 1, right? Mm-hmm. Where you're talking about how staying thankful and using your imagination to imagine God's promises coming to pass in your life will keep the joy of the Lord working in your heart. And this is a great book and a great series. So subscribe today and be eligible for that. And also, if you haven't checked out our resources on our website, I'd like to just personally encourage you, please do that. You know, a lot of people are out there, you're doing your best to stand for Christ, but you don't know what to say, you don't know who to talk to, you don't know how to do it. We've got all kinds of material on there that will help you do that, like Back to School, a resource for parents in schools, how to fight the LGBT agenda in our schools, all kinds of voting resources and voter guides and party platforms, and just, I can't even begin to go through it, how to run for office. So check out our resources page today. You'll be glad you did. Also, if you are not a member of the Truth and Liberty Coalition, we want to invite you to consider doing that. We are operating. We're doing what we're doing here because of the generosity of our members. We are so thankful for all of you who support us financially. If you want to be a part of that, the Bible talks about koinonia. It uses the same word for fellowship it uses for partnering in the gospel. If you want to partner with us at Truth and Liberty, you can do that by becoming a member today. Go on our website to the donate page, and where it says become a member, click there and sign up to give at least $5 a month or more on a recurring automatic basis, and you will become a Truth and Liberty member. And we'll send you a free gift in the mail. I think the gift right now is Alex McFarland's book, and it's an awesome book, and you'll be glad you did. Keep in mind, those gifts aren't tax deductible, unfortunately, since we're a 501c4, not a 501c3. But like I say, and Andrew says, God still notices and He'll give you credit. So you'll be glad you did. If you need prayer tonight, got trained prayer ministers, Word of God trained, Spirit-filled men and women of God. We see miracles every day coming out of our prayer center here. Call in at 719-635-1111 and let someone agree with you in prayer. And then the last thing I'd mention is this, as Andrew said, it's an interactive process. Post your comments and questions on our chat function there on our website or in the comments section on Facebook, and we'll do our very best to get you your questions tonight for Andrew and Janet, and we're looking forward to this live cast.
So thanks, Richard. And this is Janet Porter. We've had her on my Gospel Truth program, and I think you were on for, what, a week or?
Yeah, almost. Four days.
And it was awesome. And she had a great response. But real quickly, she's from Ohio. She's the one that introduced the heartbeat bill, started that process. And now I think there's, what, 29 states that have introduced legislation and 14 that have passed it?
Yes. When the governor of Texas, Governor Abbott, signs it, that'll be 14. Yeah. In fact, this month, that'll be the third bill this month.
And you were told that it just couldn't be done. But basically, this heartbeat bill is once they detect a heartbeat, you cannot cause an abortion after the heartbeat is detected.
Yep. If a heartbeat's detected, the baby's protected.
Janet is just a fighter. We had her on and she gave the story. This book right here, you've written 6 books is what your biography says. Mm-hmm. And this is one of her books, A Heartbeat Away. And she's just a powerful lady. We've got her website on the screen, and we encourage you to visit that. And you've been on all of these programs. You've been on everybody's program.
But none with more response than your program. I mean, I had to reprint the book because there were so many people that wanted it after being on your program.
Oh, that's awesome.
And I got calls from all over the country. Can you help us start a heartbeat bill here and there in Canada and this state and that state? And it was absolutely overwhelming. It was wonderful.
Praise God.
It was wonderful.
If you haven't heard Janet before, you will know by the time this is over tonight that, man, she's a go-getter.
Yes.
I'd hate to be in Janet's way. She's liable to just run smooth over the top of you, but we need that kind of determination. And specifically, we might talk about some of the abortion issues if we have time, but specifically, we've got something we want you to deal with on the Equality Act.
Sure.
Tell them what's going on here.
Sure. You know, all the advances we've been making in the pro-life arena, and everything from parental consent, the woman's right to know, all of the pro-life advances we've made in the last nearly 50 years could be wiped out with one bill. Matt Staver of Liberty Council said, oh, wait a minute, if you look at H.R. 5, it's the federal so-called Equality Act. It's really the Inequality Act. Mm-hmm. It's an attack on religious freedom. It's an attack on women, attack on children, but it also repeals every pro-life law we've ever passed. Most people don't realize
that. Now, how does it do that?
Well, it says that you can't discriminate based on pregnancy, childbirth, or related medical conditions. And a related medical condition dealing with pregnancy is abortion. And if you can't discriminate in any way, then they basically takes one judge to say, yeah, that we're going to wipe out every other pro-life law we've passed.
So even though 14 states, with the addition of Texas, will have said that they hold this heartbeat bill and stuff, it would just override that.
It would override them all, according to Matt. And it's dangerous in every other way. It basically is a way to shut down your Christian adoption agencies, any of your... it'll come after the churches. You remember in Texas not too long ago, they went after and they listened to their sermons. They told the pastors, you got to turn in your sermons. If you preach of what God says in Romans, Leviticus, 1 Corinthians, such were some of you and living in a homosexual lifestyle, guess what? They're going to come after you. You're going to try and shut down your church. But it also opens up the doorway to anybody who claims to be a woman. You can, just with a simple costume change, a serial rapist could walk into a women's shelter, a women's prison, a locker room at the local gym or your high school. It is what puts, in fact, some are calling it political rape. It is what takes away the safeguards that women most desperately need. And then beyond that, it basically indoctrinates.
You don't have to go beyond that.
Is that enough?
Persuaded.
I'm just going to tell you, it's worse than you think, and it's later than you know.
But you know, I can think of all kinds of people that if that's all it took is just to say, today I feel like a woman, and he goes into a woman's shower.
And with his camera phone and whatever.
It's just terrible. Uh-huh. It is hard to believe that people are actually considering this and thinking it's the right thing to do.
You know, they're so focused on these people who have this gender confusion and how they feel. They're not thinking about the millions and millions of women out there whose privacy is just being thrown right out the window.
It's the women's discrimination bill. In fact, you can say goodbye to women's sports.
Yeah.
Because anybody, you can have a mediocre athlete who's a male who wants to get all those scholarships and go to school for free. Guess what? All he has to do is claim to be a woman that day, and boom, he can probably outrun most women.
And again, that is not what might happen. It's already happened.
They've
already had women lose scholarships because they would have won the races, but these two guys competed and won and outperformed them.
Yeah. This would mandate it nationwide. Wow. And if you're a Christian school and you happen to think that's maybe not such a good idea, they're going to close you down. They're coming after you. In the same way, if you want to have a Christian dorm and maybe your daughter has a roommate, it's Bruce claiming to be a woman, as we've seen with Caitlyn Jenner. It's the same thing.
And what's
going
to happen there? You put a man in a woman's dorm.
Yeah. It's basically someone with a simple costume change says, I claim to be a woman. He could be a serial rapist. It's an invitation to harm women, and it needs to stop. And so we basically said, all right, what can we do to stop it? All right, remember when we were talking about the heartbeat bill? We had a federal heartbeat bill that's pending right now. And we said, all right, we'll send faxes. That seemed like a pretty good thing to do. And by the time we reached 400,000 faxes, Congress shut us down. They said, you can't do it anymore. You've broken our fax machines. You've shut down business. And so, all right. So let's try emails. And so by the time, and I wrote about it in my book, by the time we get to 910,000 emails that Congress called us up and said, you need to stop. You're shutting down business.
Wow.
If I knew how close I was to a million, I probably would have kept going a little
longer. That's really good that Congress would call you and
they
say,
said,
we can't handle it.
We're going to
make crying
making
uncle.
You stop. Yeah.
That's
so
awesome.
But at least right now, they are not censoring us. They're censoring us everywhere else. But in the U.S. Postal Service, we can still send things through the mail.
Well, they get money for it.
They do.
Well, there you go.
And so we said, all right, what can we do that will get noticed? And sometimes when you have letters, it goes off to an operations center, but a postcard doesn't need to be scanned or anything like that. And so we said, all right, what if we did an orange postcard? Orange is sort of the color of warning. Mm-hmm. And so I put together this little postcard, and it was a team of us. People like Rick Scarborough, there were people like Lou Engel was part of it, Larry Tomczak, Rick Scarborough, Rick Joyner, a whole bunch of people, Jim Garlow, a bunch of folks. And we put this thing together, and it just basically says, we say no. Mm. And so we said, all right, let's go on a website. Let's make it easy. And so we've got this website, and it explains what it is. It's we say no to the misnamed Equality Act and all the dangerous compromise versions, because that's the way they're trying to get a lot of squishy Republicans to vote for this thing so that they can get their 60 votes and they won't have to break the filibuster, right? Mm. So we've spelled it out, how this will destroy religious liberty, it'll eradicate free speech, repeal pro-life laws, endanger women, and harm children. So we spell this out. In fact, Matt Staver said, this is unquestionably the most destructive legislation in American history. That's saying something. Mm, yeah. So, all right, so we've got these postcards. You go to a website called stophr5.com. Mm-hmm. You click one button. Now, you can send a postcard to each of your U.S. senators for $9.95. We'll print them, we'll personalize them, we'll mail them for you for less than 10 bucks.
So all they have to do is click the button.
Click a button, fill in their name, city, and state, boom, done. But the better way to go is to click one button, and we'll send 110 postcards for you the same way. Mm. We'll print it, we'll personalize it, we'll sign it with a handwriting signature, so it comes from you to every member of the U.S. Senate, to the White House, And because this might end up, God forbid, if passed, before the Supreme Court, we want to make sure that all the court justices know where America stands. And this will go to all nine justices as well, with one click of a button. And so the good news is, this is, you know, we hear a lot of bad news out there, but we are now at almost 900,000 postcards. That's so we're nearly a million.
That's how many that have already committed.
That have already sent them. They're already mailed. I talked to a Senate office this morning, and they're getting them. In fact, if you stacked them up flat, they would be just about 5 feet on every senator's office right now, every desk, five feet high. All right, they're going to be noticed. And what it does is it gives our people encouragement. You know,
and you got a little graphic of that, don't you?
We do. In fact, here's what it looks like right now. It is 4 feet. I think it's 9 inches at the moment, almost 5 feet, and this is how tall it is on every senator's desk right now. But when
That's
we get
awesome.
Another 120,000 or so, we're going to be at a million. And when we're at a million, what that means is if we stack these up flat, all right, from the ground, it would go up to the top of the United States Capitol building. But that's just getting started. Then put the Washington Monument on top of the Capitol building, and that's how many postcards we'll be sending.
Oh, Janet, that's amazing.
Yeah, if you
that's
lay them awesome. Out end to end, 95 miles once we reach that million mark, and we're almost there.
I wonder what that's going to do to the Senate to have all of these cards coming in, and what are they going to do with them and stuff?
Yeah. I'm hoping somebody uses it as a wonderful visual aid on a floor debate.
I was going to say, when they debate this, somebody ought to bring in all of these bags of stuff and show them. Here's
kind of like Mr. Smith goes to Washington.
That's
Remember
right.
that scene when he hauls it all in there and
there
dumps it on the ground?
There it is. So America is responding. It's amazing to see, and it's going to not only encourage our friends, but I believe it's going to put the fear of the next election in any senator who faces this, because when you get that much mail that quickly, we just started this a month ago, and I just believe, honestly, because of what I've seen already from the response on your program, I believe that what we're going to see is when people go to stophr5.com, click that button, that just the audience from this program could bring us over a million.
So for those of you that aren't aware, we made television programs that will be aired, I think it's sometime in June. I forgot what they said.
That's about right.
We have a turnaround on this. So anyway, that will be going out. But those of you watching tonight, you can go to that website, which is
stophr5.com.
And they are asking for $29.95. That covers their cost of printing these and mailing them. And so for that one gift of $29.95, you press one button and it goes to every senator, to the White House, and to all of the Supreme Court justices.
And to be honest with you, there are costs that are not built into that price, right?
So it's not like you're making money.
You're not making money on it, but I will say that if you mailed them yourself, if you printed them and mailed them yourself, it would cost you $40 just in postage. Mm-hmm. But because we're doing it in first-class bulk rate, we're able to do it in a more effective way. But yeah, it will come from you to each senator, to the Supreme Court, and to the White House. And it's never been easier to be this effective.
So how urgent is this? Where is the bill in the Senate right now?
And sure.
Do we need to act now?
We need to act now, and I'll tell you why. Because it's already passed the House. All they need to do is call for this vote in the Senate, and they can break their own filibuster rule. They can get some of the squishy Republicans to say, well, I'll go for a compromise, which, by the way, the compromise...
Explain
they're calling
that,
it,
because
sure.
this is the first I'd heard about the compromise today.
They're calling it, you know, they've slapped a lovely name on this. This thing's called the Equality Act. It should be called the Criminalization of Christianity Act. But this compromise version, they're calling it Fairness for All Act. Isn't that lovely sounding? But what it does is it criminalizes our beliefs. It shuts down our churches, and it puts women and children in harm's way and repeals every pro-life law.
So what is the compromise?
So the compromise says, well, we're going to take some pastors and you're going to have a few rights for a little while longer. We're still going to let you practice your faith within the four walls of your church, but look out, we're coming after you next. But it still repeals our freedom of speech. It still comes after the women in the locker rooms and the prisons and the shelters. It still indoctrinates children. We didn't even mention what else it does to parents' rights as well. So let me just imagine, they're cranking up the indoctrination. It's bad enough already. But this federalizes the school curriculum that says if Johnny is more artistic and maybe he's got more nurturing skills or something like this, this kid becomes confused and they say, well, Johnny, maybe you really are a female. Maybe 7-year-old little boy is confused and he thinks he's a girl, and then suddenly they all embrace it and they say, let's call you, you know, Joanne or something like this. And he comes home and he tells his mom and says, you know, I'm a girl. I'm really a girl. And so if a parent, any Christian parent, would take him aside and said, no, Johnny, you're just confused. And this is what the Bible says. Or if a pastor,
I would think that even non-Christians would rebel at that.
Yeah, you would think. Or a pastor to say, here's what God's Word has to say about it. That will be illegal. You as a parent cannot prevent your minor child, even a 7-year-old, even a 12-year-old, cannot prevent them not only from getting hormones that may leave them sterile, these puberty-blocking hormones, or from getting a surgery that would basically castrate your child, that would mutilate and cut off healthy body parts. It's the most
this
absurd.
This is from the pit of hell.
It really is. I mean, and yet to think it's come this close to passage, that we've already seen it through the House. The president, you know, Joe Biden is calling for it.
He said he would sign it, right?
I don't use that phrase to describe him. but yeah, he wants to sign it, and yeah, that is their plan, and it could happen at any time. All they have to do is waive their filibuster like they do every time they confirm a judge, and this thing could become law, and that's why we need to act right now.
Wow. So what would stop, if this passes, what would stop them from making churches hire homosexuals and transgender individuals and ministries like this one?
This would do basically is say that gender choice and homosexuality and all of these things are like a civil right. Just like, you know, ethnic.
Right. Every cross-dresser within a 100-mile radius would beat a path to your door to try to get hired. And when you say, no, I'm sorry, we're not hiring right now, then they're going to sue you. And then the federal government is going to come as those cases go before, and they're going to try and shut you down. That's the plan.
Here in Colorado, we've got the really famous case, the cake baker, Jack Phillips, who he was attacked under state law, not federal, but he is now in his third lawsuit, and it's only
He's
the grace of God.
He's already won at the Supreme Court, and yet the state just keeps attacking.
Well, and they keep coming. New plaintiffs keep coming, and they're trying to make that federal law.
That's the introduction to this happening across the nation. Right. That's exactly what they want to do, and it's going to come in your churches and your Sunday school classes. I mean, you've seen the drag queen story hour.
Right. Yeah.
That's what your Sunday school class is going to look like if this thing passes and we comply with this.
You know,
law.
This is wrong on a moral basis, but then just on a constitutional basis to take control away from the states and give it to the federal government just makes it easier for somebody to take control and do all these things. We need to fight against this.
And that's why I wanted to make sure that we send the postcards to the Supreme Court as well. Because if, God forbid, this passes, it will end up before the court. And they've not known for courage, as we've seen in the last several months. But we've got to let them know America does not want this. And we're doing it. It started off as an orange wave, but now with nearly 1 million cards, it's an orange tsunami. We're building an orange wall of resistance against this evil, and America's being heard.
Wouldn't it be awesome if we put you over the top tonight?
I think it'd be great.
Amen. We don't know how many people watch this, but you know, if every one of you would just go to that stophr5.com, click on that button to send 110 of these postcards, man, that'd be awesome.
And you can do it for less than $30, $29.95, and it just covers our costs of printing and postage. So,
well, we just need 1,000 people to do the 100 cards, and you're there, right?
There you are. Right. Yeah. It's exciting. I just think it's a great talking point for Senator Cruz. I called also Senator Hawley today, that they'll be able to say, they're stacked up as high as the Capitol, and then the monument on top of that, or 95 miles. You know, the environmentalists aren't going to like it, I'm sure, but maybe that'll make them stop pushing bills that are this horrendous, this dangerous.
Well, that's
praise
awesome.
God, that's great.
Also, before we get away from it, would you tell them about this case that is going to go to the Supreme Court now about abortion? That's really good news.
Yeah, definitely.
And this is not off topic, really, because Janet is one of the major sponsors of this heartbeat bill, so she's really into the pro-life movement.
Well, it's news. Today, the United States Supreme Court voted to hear. Now, they didn't vote one way or the other in the case. All they did was say, we'll hear it. But there's a case out of Mississippi, and the law that's in question is a ban on abortions after 15 weeks. So the court will hear the arguments on the question of whether it's constitutional to ban abortion before the baby is viable outside the womb. This is a direct attack on Roe versus Wade. And if we've got If you take Roberts out of the equation, you still have five conservative justices, which is all it would take to reverse Roe v. Wade. So this may be the best opportunity in 40 years to reverse that decision. So
now, what happens if this goes to the Supreme Court and they vote for all of that, but then this equality bill goes through? Would that, which one would win?
Well,
what would happen?
So they're a little bit different. If they reverse Roe v. Wade, it probably goes back to the states for states to decide whether abortion is legal or illegal in their states. Now, the federal government could come along and pass a law banning.
If they make this a civil right,
yeah,
Trump.
That's right.
These individual
it would.
States' rights.
Yeah, it would. It would.
And it would have to go to the court again and hopefully get a reverse, but you can't count on the court.
No,
they're the
you
ones
can't.
That you know, redefined marriage and
right.
made it into something it's
right.
not.
And I would assume that while it's in litigation, that it would probably, people would start obeying it.
Yep, yep.
Oh, you know it. Yeah.
Under fear of the government.
Right.
Reprisal.
Yeah. It's appalling.
Terrible.
You know, I wanted to say, too, that as we talked about the heartbeat bills that are working their way through the courts, people say, oh, they've been blocked by the courts. That's part of the process. You know, we've crafted these things to be an arrow to pierce the heart of Roe versus Wade. And an arrow, in order to advance, you've got to pull it back, all right? Mm-hmm. So it's pulled back. It's launched through the court system. And I believe it's going to deliver the fatal blow to Roe versus Wade. And I hope the Mississippi bill does it first.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't, what we've got is a way in the door, a crack in the door, because when the Arkansas, our buddy Jason Ray, who passed the first heartbeat bill in Arkansas, that kept me going for another 8 years. But what happened was the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled and said, hey, the Supreme Court, take this case up. They didn't, but they basically said that the heartbeat bill has found a more certain and consistent marker than viability. Yeah. Viability is a guess. You know, they take a guess, they do a measurement, they take a measurement, and they take a guess, which could be as much as 90% wrong.
Mm.
But once you've got a beating heart, you've got, you want to know the likelihood of survival to live birth? It's 95 to 98%. So you've got a more scientific, a more certain, more consistent marker. And this is what's going to be able to give the court, I believe, a way to move the allowable protection from viability, which is miles away from our goal of conception, to heartbeat, which is inches away. And so what we're looking at is an opportunity that if the Mississippi case doesn't do it, there are a dozen other heartbeat
right.
bills that are on their way to do the job.
So one of the ways that you check a person to see if they're alive is if they have a heartbeat. So if you have a heartbeat, they have to be alive. That makes sense.
It's got a human mom and dad and a heartbeat. That sounds like a living human being to me.
And I'll tell you another little fun fact is in the Gonzales v. Carhart case, there was a unanimous finding of fact. Now, when we drafted the first heartbeat bill, we talked about detectable heartbeat. We talked about cardiac activity, discernible heartbeat, all these kinds of things. We ended up with detectable heartbeat. We didn't know at the time that the Gonzales v. Carhart case, the partial birth abortion case, there was a unanimous finding of fact in that case that said if you have a detectable heartbeat, you have not a potentially living fetus, you have a living fetus. Mm-hmm. Fetus is, of course, the Latin word for young one, developing human, unborn child, right? So we've got a finding of fact in the Supreme Court already that says if you've got a heartbeat, you've got a living baby, and that baby should be legally protected as any other human being throughout the law.
And explain the Roe versus Wade thing had a bill, what do you call it anyway? They had a part of that thing that if you could prove that this child was a human being, then it's it has access to all of the protections that everybody else
That's
has.
Right. Mm-hmm. Harry Blackmun said it. He was the author of Roe versus Wade,
mm-hmm.
and he has basically announced that this is on borrowed time because science has proven. I mean, we're looking at, can I tell you, both of these issues are dealing with those who are denying science.
Yeah.
You know, it's like when we
That's
brought
right.
in the That's youngest right. to ever testify, and that little unborn baby's heart was seen and heard in the hearing in the Judiciary Committee in Congress and in the state legislatures.
Mm.
And the people who are fighting us are the ones who are denying science. You know, they put the camera in my face. They were all like, you know, Janet and her gimmicks and Janet and her stunts. I said, isn't it sad that to defend your pro-abortion position, you've got to deny science. You've got to run from technology.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they're doing with HR5, the same thing. Because you're denying science. If you've got an XY chromosome, you are biologically a male.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to deny science? Really?
Yeah.
I mean, we had, I'll just give you one example. We had a woman dressed as a man, pretending to be a man, talking about his abortion. I'm thinking something here is just, you know, you can't
what?
Have it both ways. I mean, really? This is, I mean, it's just like a great big game of dress up and pretend. Somebody needs to say the emperor has no clothes. You know, we've got to look at science here for a moment. It's really come to that.
Weren't you also part of this thing with Times Square where you had somebody actually?
Yeah, they had a beating heart right there. I wasn't you know, behind doing that, but I was certainly supportive of it. And that's it. We had.
Well, they had a woman that somehow or another they put on those big screens.
Yeah, Abby Johnson.
Yeah, Abby Johnson.
You know, she used to work for Planned Parenthood. She endorsed my book and she believes.
We had her on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, she believes this is what's going to be what brings Roe crashing to the ground. Again, I'm rooting for anything.
I remember when she was on the show, she said that it was just like you could hear a pin drop all through Times Square when that ultrasound was up there on that screen.
You know, the same was true in Congress. Mm. You know, there were people who were disruptive. They're all dressed in purple, and they were all, you know, they were causing all kinds of havoc. And when that baby's heartbeat, little baby Lincoln, 20 weeks old, was...
To explain the whole thing. You're referring to it as if everybody knows.
Sorry. We talked about it last time I was on, and they may not remember, but we actually rolled in a mobile ultrasound in Ohio. We did it in Texas. We did it in Congress, where we had a little baby...
This is U.S. Congress.
...in the U.S. Congress for the federal heartbeat bill. And so there were people in the room, and they were disruptive, but when little baby Lincoln heartbeat was seen and heard. You could see it. There, you know, Congressman King was describing what was happening. We're hearing the heartbeat. The room was silent. But beyond that, one of the people who had been previously disruptive, one of the protesters, was seen wiping tears from her eyes. Mm. And that's when I realized, wait a minute, if this baby's heartbeat can reach even the hardest of hearts, it's going to reach America. And that's what's happened.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing how people have accepted the lies.
Yes.
And talk about it's a woman's choice. It's, you know, it's their health care, and you don't want to get between her and her doctor and stuff. And it's not about that at all.
Or him and her doctor. Sorry.
That's right. But it's not about that at all. What about the child? That child has rights, and you do not have the right to take another person's life.
No.
That is another person.
No. Absolutely.
It's the ultimate. Ultimate right and freedom. Yeah.
And when you don't value life, you know, I say this and I get in trouble for saying it, but people, when you talk about where this Equality Act could go, and they think that'll never happen, but anybody who would take the life of a child in their mother's womb or even after they're born and just let them die, people that will do that would do anything.
That's right.
I don't think that you can say that any of this stuff is beyond their ability. So
everything
that we're predicting, I believe, is going to happen if that bill passes. Mm. We've got to fight against it and stop it now.
Yes, we do. I wrote a book called The Criminalization of Christianity back in 2005. And a lot of people said, I basically said that Christians would go to jail for their faith in America. And people said, that's hyperbole. Jan, that's exaggeration. Mm. That's too far. But every single thing that I've predicted has come true in pockets, in small areas. What this would do, what H.R. 5 would do, is make it the federal law, that the criminalization of Christianity would become the federal law, and we would either bow to the homosexual agenda or we will go to jail.
There was a preacher in London that was arrested last week or week before. There was a pastor in Canada arrested on the streets for not shutting his church down. Yep. Rodney Howard Brown was arrested. So you're not exaggerating.
They gave us two cease and desist orders.
That's
and
right.
We had to fight that and go to court. I mean, it is not what's coming. It's here.
Yeah. And
is just empowering.
I just want to say something. I just want to publicly say thank you for standing. For not bowing to this appalling government intrusion, to this tyranny. You know, our friend Louis Gohmert in Texas, the congressman from Texas, he said, you know, this is 1984. The only thing they got wrong in the book was the year. You know, the left thinks it's a manual, it's an instruction manual or something, but you didn't bow. And I just want to say thank you publicly.
Well, thank you for what
you did. It's so great to meet men of courage in today's army of the Lord.
Well, we didn't enjoy it, but you know, if you give them freedoms that they don't have, they aren't going to give them back to you.
No.
That's right.
This was an overreach of government, and we had to stand up and fight it, or they would never give it back.
That's right.
So it was really important to stand against this.
Janet, I think you've got some figures on here about, you know, this transgender stuff and the number of people that overcome these feelings and regret and this kind of thing.
Senator Rand Paul was talking to the transgender man dressed as a woman to be the assistant director of Department of Health.
This is the one that Focus on the Family got banned because they called him a him. instead of a girl.
Yeah, which is biologically accurate. One of the points he made in this is that according to the American College of Pediatricians, if you don't indoctrinate and support and give hormone therapy to a child who's confused, this suffers from a mental disorder. By the way, it is still a mental disorder listed in the American Psychiatric Association Book of Disorders, right? So if this kid's confused, they're not sure, you know, whether they're a boy or girl, you leave them alone. And then, according to the American College of Pediatricians, 80 to 95% will come to the resolution that they are, in fact, the gender that God made them to be. That God did not make a mistake. That they are comfortable, and that they are resolved in the gender that they were born as. And so that's something that people don't. You know, if you interject and say, I've talked to Walt Heyer, this man who had the surgery, who regretted it, who gets letters every day from people all over the world that say, I've had this surgery, I regret it, or I'm thinking about it, I don't want to, you know, this, all of these things. He said what happened was his grandmother used to dress him up as a girl. And he got affirmation. She brushed his hair as a wig, you know, you make a cute girl. And this is what, they become confused because when a child is so young and that's where they're getting their affirmation, they wake up, they end up being confused. And that's what's happened. It's happening all over Hollywood. And it's being affirmed by everyone, which again, just not only puts these people in harm's way. I mean, I mentioned before the program, I'm praying for Bruce Jenner, who goes by Caitlyn Jenner. I'm praying against the suicide. The suicide that happens with people that engage in this kind of thing. It's very, very sad when you think about it.
Homosexuals have like three times as much suicide as heterosexuals, and then you go into transgender and it just continues to go up. It's a very destructive lifestyle.
Yeah. They have a shorter life expectancy.
They have 20 years less that the homosexual lives than a heterosexual. And, you know, cigarettes take an average of 7 years off of a person's life. So homosexuality is three times worse than smoking. We ought to put a label across their forehead. This could be hazardous to your health.
You know, it's funny. One of the videos I made that was banned from YouTube, it was called Heather Has Two Cigarettes. And it was this teacher in this little grade school, and there's, you know, and Abraham Lincoln was a smoker, and they had all the kids say smoker, and Michelangelo was a, and the kids all say smoker, and Barack Obama was a smoker. You see the pictures, and what do you want to be when you grow up? And they all say smoker, except one little girl who's sent to the principal's office because, you know, that's a hate crime. You're a smokophobe, right? But the whole point is, it is three times more dangerous than smoking. We wouldn't hand out cigarettes in schools, and yet that's what they're doing with this agenda.
It's so hypocritical, everything that they do. And, you know, this is another thing. This is minor, I guess, compared to some of the things we've talked about. But there would be for Christians to try and talk somebody who is confused about their gender out of it. That would be against the law.
Well, it's illegal in
they call it conversion therapy.
Yeah. Oh yeah, New Jersey it's illegal. New California it's illegal. I mean, how appalling is this that you know that we're trying to legislate their opinion, their agenda? I listened to your teaching today about the self-centeredness that people are going around today, and they're like, that offends me. I'm sorry, but that shirt blue makes me feel uncomfortable, and you need to change it, and I don't like it. And so you need to adjust your world around what makes me comfortable. That's what they're doing with legislation like this. They're trying to make it illegal to disagree.
And we need to take some questions, but I want to ask this question. You've dealt with this more than I have. Why are people so motivated? I know it's the devil ultimately, but is there any logic, is there any rationale to why they're pushing this? What's the purpose?
You know, it's interesting. I remember when we did a thing called the Truth and Love campaign. We ran full-page ads all over the country about the hope for change for those who are struggling with homosexuality that have left it. It's interesting that we were banned by, you know, the San Francisco Board of Supervisors banned us. We weren't allowed to advertise and all these things. But they're looking for affirmation. They are looking for. I remember Newsweek did an interview. And they said, "How long have you known that you were a heterosexual?" And these kinds of things. Look, I introduce myself as Janet. Hi, I'm Janet. I'm a woman. I'm a Christian. I'm pro-life. I'm all these many, many things. But to a homosexual, that becomes their identity. And if you don't affirm it, then they see it as an affront to who they are. And what they're doing is they're trying to make it illegal to disagree with them.
Let me ask it this way. Why is Pelosi and others that aren't homosexuals, why are they pushing it so hard? Because it's not their identity.
Yeah. What's going on?
Well, it's catering to their constituency. You've got the Black Lives Matters, you've got the homosexual agenda, the transgender. It's honestly, look at it, you look in Revelation. And it says that, you know, those that are godly are going to be more godly. Those that are evil are more evil. And it looks just like that now. Where it used to be that I used to have, when I would do a pro-life bill, I had maybe 14, 15 Democrats on a bill. On a heartbeat bill, I had one guy of courage, Bill Patman, to sign on. Now the Democrats are coming to a place where, was it you that said maybe earlier today, I heard you say that God made two genders, the Democrats made all the rest, right? And that's really, they feel like if they don't embrace this and everything it includes, then they're going to be ostracized. You see what happens. I mean, even somebody that says that they support Israel, now that's become a pariah and you're going to be treated like, oh, you're, you know, support terrorism or something like this. It's appalling. The Democrats used to support Israel. Some of them used to be pro-life. Some of them used to actually have some very solid family values.
We actually had Lauren Boebert, the congresswoman who's a gun-toting congresswoman. She was on with us last week, and she says she's made friends with some of the Democrats, and personally, they are pro-life, but they will not say so because Pelosi would just do away with them.
They lose
any influence.
It's cancel culture. That if you disagree with all of these radical beliefs, with the Marxism that's behind the agenda right now, then we're going to ostracize you. We're going to, you know, replace you, silence you, and ultimately criminalize
you. A culture of shame.
Mm-hmm. Somebody needs to read the Constitution, because there's a newsflash. There is no right to not be offended in
that's
the Constitution.
Right.
It's
Amen.
To protect all speech. You know, the whole idea is to let all ideas be heard, let the best one win. And what they want to do, because the best idea would win, they're trying to silence everyone who disagrees. And then they want to get the safe spaces. It's like they're building a cardboard fort under the dining room table or something. They want safe spaces where nobody can say anything to them. It might hurt their feelings. Why?
That's so childish.
They can't, exactly. Mm. They can't win on its merits.
Now, have you ever noticed how their arguments, when you push them into a corner, all of a sudden they just start name calling?
Yeah.
They don't have a solid philosophical foundation for what they believe. Unlike the biblical worldview where everything comes back to God. But once you abandon God, you don't have any foundation left.
Yeah, and all they do is name call. That is.
Well, I tell you, we're in a critical situation, but I believe I have a word from God that we are in the third great awakening, and I believe we're going to overcome this, and this is going to be a part of it. So once again, before we go to questions, tell them how they can participate and help send some of these cards.
Sure. Just go to stophr5.com. It's never been easier. Just stophr5.com. Click a button. You can send one to each of your U.S. senators for $9.95. Or the better, more economical, and more effective way is send 110 to 100 senators to the White House, to the 9 Supreme Court justices for less than the price of postage if you mailed them yourself. $29.95.
That's awesome.
It's a great deal.
Awesome.
We're not making money on it, but I will say we are making a difference.
Amen. That's awesome. Awesome.
That is awesome.
So we got any questions, Richard?
Yes, sir, we do. Let's see here. One of these, Curtis wants to know, and I'm just dovetailing what you just said, why flooding Congress with postcards will matter.
Well, here's why. Because, you know, we've called them, we've emailed them, we've faxed them, we've done all these things. But if you are a squishy Republican, and you're getting lobbied to sign on to this counterfeit, you know, so-called compromise bill, if you've got a stack in your office that's this high on your desk, I'm guessing you're going to think twice about getting on a compromise bill, because this addresses specifically the compromise as well.
Mm.
All right? So it's to go after the squishy Republicans. It's to give courage to those who are standing with us. That they're going to feel like, you know, oh my goodness, America stands with me. I'm not just the lone wolf out here anymore. And then the third reason is, if you're fighting us, if you want to impose this, if you want to repeal our pro-life laws, attack our religious freedom, if you want to harm children and put women in danger, then they have to, every senator in the back of their mind, the thing they care about most is part of your selfish tape that I listen to. They care about their reelection. Mm-hmm. They want their job again. And they know to keep their job, they've got to get the votes. I mean, we've got to worry about voting integrity, of course, and that needs to be reestablished. But right now, what we're going to do is give courage to our friends. We're going to keep the squishes where they need to be in voting against this and the compromise bill, and put the fear, if not fear, the not the fear of God, the fear of next election in
and
our
we've homes. Had a number of congressmen on this program, and every one of them we've asked a question similar, and they say it matters.
Mm-hmm.
When they see all of these things, And they said, one of them in particular said that, you know, people support them and they run for office, and then after they get in, the people that support them, they don't ever hear from them. All they hear from is the critics.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so when you, if you write to these Republicans that may be on the fence and wavering, man, to see a stack of 5 foot of postcards, I think it's going to be quite an encouragement.
I think it just strengthens their backbone. I talked to Senator Scott's office this morning, and they thanked me profusely.
Tim Scott,
and thanked me profusely for sending this, because they're standing for us. They're standing for our freedoms, for the Constitution, for our First Amendments, and it's so great for them to know that we're standing with them, and that's really what the postcards do.
Wow, that's great. That's great. Well, I don't want to throw any hand grenades, Janet, but this viewer wants to know, is it possible to be a Christian and still vote for this administration?
Well, I think that really what you're looking at is God had a voter guide, all right? He drew it up, and he said that there's two choices we can make. You can choose life so that we and our children can live, or you can choose death. Sure. And that is the choice of this administration. And so to be a Christian, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. That's really it. I remember I was testifying once for a bill that protects from conception. And there was this Democrat. She was not very happy with me, and I was there to testify for the bill. And she said, where do you come off saying that to be a Christian, you have to be pro-life? Where do you get off on saying that? She says, the Bible is a book about tolerance, and Jesus never used the word abortion. That was what she said to me.
Oh, man.
I said, well, if you open that book, if you open up the Bible, you'll see that thou shalt not kill made the top 10 commandments, not suggestions. And Jesus said,
great.
If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And then I went on to Proverbs 24:11, that we're commanded to rescue those being carried away to death. We're commanded in Proverbs 31:8 to be a voice for those appointed to die.
Very good.
So you can claim to be a Christian. You're a Christian in name only, perhaps. But if you love God, then you'll obey him. You'll keep his commandments. And that, I think, is really the test of who really is a Christian. And to be a Christian, you need to obey God. And this is a very basic primary thing. I can talk about all the other issues and Israel and the agenda that we're talking about now, but it really comes down as easy as choose life or death. Mm. The choice for Joe Biden was a choice for death for millions of children in the womb.
Yeah, right.
I don't believe you can be an informed Christian and vote contrary to the Bible. But there are a lot of people who have only had presented to them, you know, make Jesus your Lord so you don't go to hell. And they've never read the Bible. They don't know what the Bible says and stuff. And I believe you could be a Christian and be deceived. But you can't. I had a woman in our school that I asked her. She was real liberal before she came. And as she was exiting, she says, man, you've changed my whole life. My family won't have anything to do with me. I'm more conservative now than you are. And I got her to the side. She was a black lady. And I said, look, I'm not going to argue. Just explain to me how you could say that you were a Christian and yet you were for abortion. You were for everything that the Bible is against. How could you say that you love God? And she says, I loved God, but I didn't love the Word. Mm-hmm. Mm. She says, when I got into the Word of God, I cannot be a liberal and do that. And so you cannot be a Word-influenced believer and vote the way that people are voting. And I know that'll offend some people, but I believe it's absolutely true.
You know, I think there's people that think, well, abortion's wrong, but it's none of the government's business. What do you say to those folks?
You know, I remember I had on a guest on my radio show, that's like saying, you know, I personally disagree with slavery. I mean, I personally wouldn't have the slavery, but I don't want to interfere with those who want that right to choose to own a slave. Mm-hmm. That sounds very pious until you realize you're neglecting the one it matters the most to, the slave, you know? And the same is true with a fellow human being.
Mm-hmm. You have to deliver those that are appointed unto death.
That's right. And and what the heartbeat bill does is we're not talking about some glob of cells. We're talking about a fellow human being who has a heartbeat we can detect, we can hear. You know, if we had somebody in a mine or somebody on the other side of a wall, and you could use the instruments and hear that baby's heartbeat, we would do everything we could to rescue that child or adult who has a beating heart. And we should treat the unborn, because they're a member of our human family with the same 46 human chromosomes. It's not a rabbit or a carrot we're talking about. We're talking about a human being, a fellow child. I mean, it's obvious.
And you know, we have a mutual friend, Melissa Odin, and she's been on our program and stuff, and I'm supporting one of her getting people who have survived abortion together. There are thousands of people that have lived through an abortion, and some of these states, New Jersey's and others, have passed laws that allow children who are aborted and they somehow or another survive to just lay there and die. Mm.
Yeah.
That's inhuman.
It's homicide.
It is.
Yeah, we brought Melissa in to testify for our bill, and she talked about how abortion not only kills the life of the child, but the generations that would follow.
That's right.
So I'll just tell you a little secret. I'm holding her little 3-year-old child, Olivia, on my lap, and Melissa's up in front of the committee giving her testimony, and she's making this point about abortion kills, wouldn't just take my life, but the life of my daughter. And so I just said, do you want to go see mommy? And she looked at me and I, can I? And she ran right up and she picked her up. It was a Kodak moment, right? It was one of those moments where it was
You stir the pot.
Visualize,
I do. Just don't have any fear over stuff. That's great.
It was fun.
I love it. You know, we had a woman that we interviewed, and she was 103 years old when we interviewed her, and she was raped when she was a little girl, and she was on my program, and I interviewed her, and she said she didn't even know enough about sex to understand what happened. She didn't even understand. And this is back before they allowed abortion, and so her family sent her to a convent, and she had this child put it up for adoption. And when the child was 80-something years old, she had some kind of a deal, and the doctor wanted to go back into her family and find out what the genetics were, and so she started looking up who her birth mother was, and it turned out that she was still alive.
My. Wow.
And when the girl was 80-something years old, she reconnected with her mother, who was 98 at that time.
Oh, my.
And it turns out that one of her children had been an astronaut. There were two that were congressmen, and all of these things would have not happened if they would have aborted that child.
Wow. And you know, the same people that advocate for abortion are supposedly in favor of civil rights, and yet abortion among the blacks is twice that as it is among white people. And they put Planned Parenthood clinics in minority neighborhoods. So how can that not be?
Margaret Sanger started Planned Parenthood specifically to get rid of the black weeds, is what she called them, in the human race.
Imagine how many more blacks we would have if it weren't for abortion.
There are more blacks aborted in, is it Washington or New York, than
both.
There are born.
In both places.
That's terrible.
I have a chapter, Behind the Mask, is Greed and Racism. And by the way, Margaret Sanger, you want to talk about the real set? If black lives really matter, let's go after the real racists.
That's right.
That's the founder of Planned Parenthood.
They need to take all of her statues down.
Oh, absolutely. And and they're still giving out awards. But what she said, let me give you the idea. What she said is that we don't want the word to get out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. Mm-hmm. I mean, the way they treated President Trump, you would have thought he said that.
Yeah.
But no, it was the founder of Planned Parenthood.
Right.
By the way, we have actually exterminated the entire population of every black man, woman, and child that was alive during 1960. 20 million black people, that's every man, woman, and child exterminated during the year of 1960. And that was their goal. They want to exterminate the Negro population. Well, they've gone a long way toward that. And if black lives really matter, then what we need to do is go after abortion, because that is the ultimate racist agenda.
Black lives matter and Planned Parenthood are in bed together because they both have the same goal of destabilizing our society and overturning stuff.
Yeah.
Well, here's another question, Janet, and this one's getting a little bit.
Get another grenade for me?
No, but this one's kind of a disturbing subject, and this person asks, are you familiar with NAMBLA? So many people are like, and this is, I'm reading verbatim, are like, love is love, but how do they not see that LGBTQ are after legalizing the trafficking of children? So. Homosexuality, is it really where this is going to end, or is it going to end? Is it going to keep getting more and more perverted and destructive?
Yeah, that is part of the LGBTQ, RSTD, I mean, it goes up to however high you want to make it, but one of the letters in there deals with pedophilia, and they call it adult child sex. They tried to float some trial balloons about this, and we've got to just fight against it. The Man-Boy Love Association, that's where you see those signs, love is love, right? That's what that means. Well, no. It's something that is child abuse. It is mm-hmm. it is the molestation of children is what they actually are behind. Mm-hmm. They march with them at the parades. If you look at it, you'll see the NAMBLA people, the Man-Boy Love Association. They'll be in the parades this June.
Pride.
You watch.
Yeah.
That's part of
What's
the agenda
NAMBLA
that comes
sample?
With it. The North American
Man-Boy Love Association.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah. Pedophilia is what
yes.
it is.
Yes.
Yes. It's appalling.
And there was a parade in Colorado Springs, and on the news they showed a little boy that's probably 10 years old had a sign, love is love.
Mm.
And it's just not true.
Mm.
It's
goodness.
Not love. lust.
It's not love.
Pedophilia, bestiality is not love.
And that's what fuels the sex trafficking industry. That's right. Part of what's behind all of this child abuse and molestation that's happening.
Richard and I went to the Capitol here in Colorado, and we protested a bill that was a sex education bill. And I mean, Planned Parenthood was pushing it hard because it brings people into their deal and makes them money.
That's right.
It's demonic. It is not. It reminds me of Judas saying, why wasn't this ointment sold and given to the poor? And he didn't say because he cared anything about the poor. He was a thief, and he had his hand in the bag. And that's what our politicians are doing. They're prostituting all of these groups and taking advantage of them because it keeps them in power.
Wow.
And it harms the innocent. It harms not only the children in the womb, the young children who are being exploited. I mean, you can... Let me give you one example.
Yeah.
Amazon today. I'm not a fan of Amazon. If you want to buy a book of mine, buy it on my website. No, don't go to Amazon. Because Amazon, what they're doing now is they're banning books by those who are ex-homosexual. Yes. They're not supposed to exist, right? But what they are allowing is pedophilia books. Mm. You know, oh, Daddy, this is so wrong. I mean, titles that would make your stomach turn, they're allowed on Amazon, but you're not allowed to tell people how you've left homosexuality or a transgender lifestyle. That's not allowed because, again, we don't want people to know that they exist, and they exist by the thousands.
That's the only way that they can win the argument is to silence any opposition because it would win. Truth would win every single time.
And that's what HR5 tries to do.
Tell them again. We've got just a few minutes
here. Sure. Go to stophr5.com. Send your postcards, and we'll mail 110 of them, printed, personalized, signed by you, to all of the 100 senators, to the White House, and to the 9 Supreme Court justices. And it says, we say no. And they're getting the message. As I spoke to the Senate today, it is sending a loud and clear message that cannot be ignored. And that is really what it's all about. One click sends that much mail, and they can't ignore it.
I have some of the senators you've been talking to, have they mentioned this?
Yeah, and they thanked us.
Of an impact is it making already?
It's giving them courage. I believe it's giving them a strength and backbone to know that they are not alone in this fight, and that, you know, each person, you know, sometimes you wonder, what does my one call do? What does my one email do? Well, you're actually hitting the players, the ones who are making this decision in the Senate, the White House, and the Supreme Court, all with one click. It'll actually, less than a minute, you can mail through the post office 110 postcards that cannot be ignored.
I would think that a million of these postcards coming to all of the senators is going to make an impact.
Everybody will see them. Yeah.
I think so. Yeah. I don't think you can avoid it. How could you avoid?
They're tripping.
That's what they're
right
talking
now.
About it when they go to lunch. Hey, did you get these orange? Where are all these orange postcards?
They won't have enough room in their office for all these things.
And what I did is I put just the name, city, and state when they sign it, because I don't want to give a mailing list to a bunch of people who hate us, right?
So these are personalized.
They're personalized.
It's not like they're in person.
Yep, they're to each senator from each person with their city and state, so they can see these are real people. They've taken the time to send that. They just don't know how little time it took to do it.
Wow. Man, that's awesome. I appreciate you doing this.
It's a lot of fun to
see
America respond against this evil. You know,
and we need to do it now because the vote could come anytime.
Any day, any day. So we're advancing the kingdom of God and protecting lives, keeping hearts beating, but we're also stopping the evil. We've got to do both.
So stophr5.com is how they send these postcards.
Yeah.
How do they get your book?
You can go to faith2action.org, faith2action, or the shortcut is f2a.org. But that's a better place to get it. You'll get it one signed as well. So it's better than Amazon.
That's good. And you've got five other books that you've written.
Sure.
You've got a lot.
Criminalization of Christianity, the Light Winds documentary.
Yeah, you've got a movie, Light Winds.
I do.
We didn't even talk about that.
Yeah, well, you mentioned a lot of people like Jerry Boykin and Governor Huckabee, Bill Fetter. They're all in the movie. We interviewed 100 people around the country, and we asked them about marriage.
She's also made a sitcom. This woman is just amazing. The things that she does makes me feel like I need to get in gear.
Man,
oh, my goodness.
I'll tell you.
Anyway, we appreciate you joining us tonight, and please go to, what was it?
StopHR5.com.
And sign that. I'm going to do that as soon as we get through. I've been making programs all day. But thank you for joining us. Remember, we do this every Monday night at 6 p.m. Colorado time. And we also want to thank CTN, who carries this on some of their network stations, for broadcasting this. It's just awesome. And I believe it's making a difference.
Amen.
I believe that this is changing people's lives. And this is good news. something good to share with you.
And the viewers are going to bring in over 1 million cards, I'm sure.
Amen.
Yes, I believe it.
Amen. So thank you for being a part. Remember, we do this every Monday. Join us again next week and go to Janet's website. We've got all that information there on the screen. God bless you. We'll see you again next week for our Truth and Liberty live cast. Good night.
Join us next time for the Truth and Liberty broadcast. Find tonight's episode and related articles and links at truthandliberty.net. Truth and Liberty is viewer supported. If you'd like to help us continue our live casts, you can make a donation at truthandliberty.net.